now we are pleased to welcome Paraskevi Kourti from Thessaloniki. She is Managing Director of Strategic Planning, Urban Development and Funding of Pavlos Melas Municipality. Her core skills include strategic planning and implementation, EU policies, urban development and social challenges. Her parallel academic interests and research involvement secures theoretical knowledge of urban policies, including the Green Agenda. She will share with us her professional experience of decision-making and strategy-shaping activities at municipality level for the case of the historic site of ex-military camp of Pavlos Melas in Thessaloniki. This presentation will give us an insight into the local obstacles of the implementation of the Green Agenda in one particular case. Trees versus heritage is a trigger for this presentation. I have compassion for a single tree, and I look forward to nature-based solution for the transformation of ex-military camp. With that in mind, I ask you to help me welcoming Paraskeva Kourti.
Hello, thank you very much for having me here today. Is my sound okay? Do you listen to me okay?
Yes.
Okay. So thank you again for having me to this seminar. Following all these exquisite presentations by academic and researchers, I feel that there are so many important aspects of this seminar that have already been mentioned. And it's a great opportunity for me to have this feeling of the academic environment again. What I hope to bring in today's discussion comes from a different point of view, let's say a managerial point of view, and it has to do with something that in my professional experience affect decision-making and policy-making in the field of heritage preservation. So allow me to share my screen. Is it okay?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. So for highlighting my arguments, I'm going through the case study of the reuse of the area of the ex-military camp of Pavlos Melas in Thessaloniki, a city in the northern part of Greece, and it's a municipal project of the urban scale. Pavlos Melas camp was established in 1895, in 1985 by the Ottoman army. That's while the city of Thessaloniki was still under Ottoman rule and in an area that at that time was a peri-urban non-habitual site. The Ottomans acquired a piece of land that was actually nearly the half of the size of today's camp and constructed a building project consisting of two long two stories barracks, four horse stables, a headquarters building and a mosque. These two buildings are the barracks, the four stables, headquarters and the mosque. The construction was assigned to German architects and engineers because Pavlos Melas, at that time called Topsu Kislasi, it was a Turkish name, was part of a bigger developmental project of buildings and infrastructure that the Ottomans operated in the city. And while they struggled to modernize and thus maintain what was left of their empire, Pavlos Melas remained a military camp in all of its history. And that means fenced in secrecy, excluding and excluded from whatever happened around it and in the rest of the city area. The Greek army succeeded the Ottoman after 1912, which is the year of the liberation of the city, and expanded the camp at nearly double of its previous land area. In the interwar period, the Greek army constructed a group of warehouses in the northwest part of the camp. And they also put up for the two barracks that consisted of replacing the internal wooden bearing system by columns and beams of concrete. At the second World War, the German army succeeded the Greek one in the status of the occupation of the camp. And from here on begins the most painful part of its history, a history connected with the most troubled and regretful decades of social and political history in Greece. The forces of occupation divided the area into half and turned the northern part into a military camp for armed forces and its southern part into a concentration camp for imprisonment, deportation and extermination of various groups of people, Jews, fighters of national resistance, hostages of various nationalities and others. The Greek army reoccupied the area of the camp, but many of its buildings continue to be used as prisons through the years of the Greek Civil War, and after that, until 1974, that the junta was over and the Third Greek Republic was established. The camp was then turned into a common military base for the armed forces until the year 2006, when abandoned by the troops without a single thought of actions needed for the protection of the historical buildings. The municipality claimed the camp from 1997, I mean the property of the land of the camp, 1997 until 2017, that's nearly 20 years, when a final agreement was set up with the Ministry of Defense. Through all of those years, the historical buildings suffered tremendous destruction from fires, thefts, and erosion. Let me note that until recently, the history of the camp was not at all known. Its Ottoman origin was not obvious because the buildings had all those Western characteristics, and the minaret of the mosque was demolished sometime early at the interwar period. Even less was known about the next important layer of history, that of being a concentration camp. We started to enrich our knowledge of the camp's past due to the research done after 2010 from the Department of Architecture of the Aristotle. Some knowledge of what happened to the Second World War came into light after a research project that was funded by the German embassy. Through this research, we were able to reconstruct the topography of the camp at the era, the way it operated, identify the names of a small number of prisoners, how many of those were deported to other camps for extermination, and how many of them were killed into sight. Municipal actions were taken in order to educate the public about the site's heritage, and that included funding a documentary, making education programs and campaigns to schools, meetings and discussions. But nevertheless, at a research that we conducted at the neighborhoods surrounding the camp, it was evident that people did not correlate to any of these fragments of history, not have any personal or family memories, and they were reluctant to reflect any further to these issues, with the exception of those citizens of old age that had also a strong political orientation towards the left or were members of the left-wing parties of Greece. Through the almost two decades of vindication and rivalry between the municipality and the Ministry of Defense about the ownership of the camp, a few proposals of rehabilitation and reuse were put up. That came from architectural competitions, in-house municipal proposals, and some of external partners. And they were all visualizing the fortunate outcome that would be if the city acquired the land. And those proposals had all something in common. The old proposed the additions of new buildings of various forms in the site. By the year 2017, that the municipality acquired the land though, we would have come through a crucial change in viewing and acting about city issues and challenges. I am referring to what have started as a major shift in action, protection of the environment, and then gradually transformed theoretical knowledge, technical solutions, policies and fundings towards what I call an environmental shift. Some say that this new reality of nature and human civilization reconciliation came out of gradual steps of humanity's cognitive maturation. And this is probably true. But if we can examine and compare past ways of responding to city challenges, it becomes obvious that it is always a move in concepts and ideas, and that in 20 years from now, people will probably be thinking very differently than what we do today. As soon as the municipality acquired the land, we had to put up a strategic plan for its reuse. We researched and analyzed various technical solutions, technical, social, environmental, and economic data about the camp and its surrounding area. Main decisions of the strategic plan was first and foremost prioritizing a project for the environmental upgrade of the open air green area of the camp in order to offer 320,000 square meters to the public, demolishing around 10,000 square meters of buildings that were of no historical value and they were poorly preserved. And then, as a third action, as a second phase action, aiming in the restoration and reuse of the historical core buildings of the Ottoman area, mainly by public uses, as well as the use of the northern part buildings by private uses of commerce and services. The project was named as Metropolitan Park of Pavlos Melas, and its budget was estimated around 62 million euros, 20 of which were needed for the green open area intervention. Besides all the data and the elements analyzed, there were two crucial factors that underlined that decision. First and foremost, the knowledge that in our municipality was various groups, organizations, NGOs that were intensively active in the environmental issues. Some of these groups played a crucial role in the negotiations with the army by putting pressure to the government of that time at the public demand of having the vacant land turned into a much needed park. The second crucial factor was the pressure for ensuring the first stage funding. Funding is the driving gear of all agendas and policy making actions. The environmental shift I was previously referring to transformed totally the funding backup scenery the last decade. And let me explain that for a few minutes more. Greece, and I guess other countries of the European South, was always heavily dependent on the structural funding of the EU, especially in the municipal level. From 2007, that was when the Lisbon Treaty was signed, and onwards, there was a crucial change in the character of policies that serve convergency. And in budget structure, that means that 25 of all EU budget is directed to social actions against unemployment or exclusion, and 50% up to 8% of the budget of the European Regional Development Fund is directed to research, innovation, new technologies, renewable energy, leaving out of eligibility, out of funding, whatever has to do with infrastructure, and infrastructure includes buildings too. So we can get an even more indicative idea of how the policy funding scenery looks like for projects of restoration and reuse in Greece by looking at the funding conditions of the operational programs of the Ministry of Culture in Greece, that was you showed in the previous tablet, and or the available funds for restoration projects in the national scale for the last 7 years. I think from this data that it becomes obvious that in terms of funding opportunities, green interventions are winning full ground. So, policy priorities and funding scenery formulate a framework for me to imply that we live in an era of trees versus heritage, and that trees are winning so far. We were aware of these conditions when we set up our plan for Pavlos Melas, and that was a very crucial reason for forwarding the green intervention first and foremost. And although we knew that the historic buildings were in a very bad condition, they were preserved in a very bad condition. As soon as our proposal was finished, the consultation process began with the public and other public and private bodies of the city. Through the discussions, one crucial point of discontent prevailed and had to do with the number of buildings that should be kept for restoration and reuse. The public was very persistent in asking for credentials that no new buildings would be built, as, and I quote a phrase from the public consultation meetings, any new construction would devour the precious land from trees. There were also proposals that asked for more buildings to be demolished. A group which I call environmental extremists because of their hardcore beliefs and actions asked for the demolishment of all buildings so that the site could be a pure green deposit. Another group of citizens that were connected to the left political party proposed that the buildings which belonged to the middle wall expansion of the camp could and should be demolished in order to make more space for vegetation and to inhibit permanent human activities to the camp. Explanations about the importance of keeping a crucial phase of the camp's history were turned down, and a quote again, a characteristic of the conflict phrase of the group's leader, that heritage talks of the past, but trees are our children's future. Other pro to this opinion arguments stated that historic buildings constantly need money while trees live out of nothing, that buildings are enjoyed by few, even if they are of public use, while parks are enjoyed by everyone. Although political and administrative personnel was affected by these claims, we concluded in keeping our plan as it was originally constructed, influenced mainly by the thought that demolishing a building is a radical, non-reversible act. It's true that, though, that in social knowledge and understanding, there was a fight that can be presented as trees versus heritage, and that the latter is actually losing. This might be true for the case of Pavlos Melas that includes an obnoxious and painful history, as well as suppressed social memories. It is surely not applicable to all cases in Greece and definitely not of universal value. But what I like to keep from this case study is that there is a social claim or notion that heritage preservation speaks about the past, while green intervention speaks about the future. And while for academics and policy officials, maybe, it is obvious that versus heritage is actually a pseudo dilemma, because rehabilitation and reuse of existing building stock is one of the most environmental friendly solutions. I am sure that this knowledge is not at all embedded. Therefore, I conclude that what the Hersus project is working on is of great value. In my opinion, it would be even of greater help if the discussion and outcomes escaped the academic environment and pursued diffusion of knowledge in a broader public, agenda setting officials in national and supranational level, lobbying and supporting the idea that heritage reuse could and should be part of the new and very promising European Green Deal, and thus be reconnected to the future. So thank you very much. I've concluded my presentation.
Thank you for the presentation. And do we have some questions? No? I have